First and foremost, I want to welcome everybody to the Oquendo Center. By a show of hands, how many of you have been in here before? Fantastic. How many of you have been in here before for one of our conversations? This is where we like to start all of our conversations out. So, you know, I want to talk a little bit about the Oquendo Center because they are actually a big piece of our regional strategic plan for medical health and wellness travel. And in your hands as you were walking in, everybody was handed a two-year accomplishments report, which is why we're here today. And one of the key areas that we focus on was medical meetings. And the Oquendo Center here is really why Las Vegas has been able to attract so many medical meetings to town. And a lot of people don't realize over the course of the last couple years, we have become either the leading destination, or we kind of battle it out with Orlando, the second largest destination where medical meetings are held. This particular center is a driver of that, and I want to give you a little bit of a backstory about the Oquendo Center. It's owned by the Western Veterinarians Association, and so it's the vets that came together. They've been holding their annual conference in Las Vegas since the mid-60s. And they were having some challenges with holding their skills labs over at the Mandalay Bay because they were bringing in animal cadavers, and Mandalay didn't want that mixed up with their food. So I imagine you could appreciate that. So hence they ended up building the Oquendo Center, and they spent double-digit millions building this place out. And as they were building it, they realized that they would have capacity, something else that we'll be talking about today with our strategic plan is how do you build capacity. And so they realized that they had capacity and they started bringing in human medicine. And today, human medicine makes up about 65% of the volume of what comes through the Oquendo Center, even to the point where they're getting ready to go through a major expansion. And I think in the next couple years, you'll see some dirt moving and you'll see the center even grow larger than it is today. What's unique is every time you come in here, you get to see something a little bit different. And so today, as I came in, they have one of the larger neurological surgery conferences going on. So they had a bunch of human heads sitting on tables. And you don't get to see that every time that you walk in somewhere. And last time I came in, they had a penile implant lab going on, and it's not for just pleasure. These were for folks that were recovering from prostate cancer. So they're doing amazing work here, and they've trained over 7,000 surgeons that have flown in from all around the world, and they come to Las Vegas to get training. That is a form of medical tourism that we'll talk about later on. Some other thanks go out to the good folks at ResortCiergeMD. You'll meet them out in the hallway after the event, as well as the Partnership to Fight Chronic Disease. Although they're not here, they have been a very big supporter of Las Vegas Heels and assist us with making these events happen. Just some housekeeping things. When we break from here today, we do have a bunch of food out there. We've got an open bar for you or a couple drink tickets. If you do need to use the restrooms, they're going to be all the way down the hall, and you'll see some restrooms down there. But we really want to make this presentation today very engaging. We handed everybody a copy of the two-year accomplishments report on your way through. Hopefully you've had a chance to read those 34 pages by now. And we want you to ask questions. So I'll be sitting over there in the chair momentarily, and it's going to be kind of a fireside chat. The good folks that are on stage with us today, Dr. Stowe Shoemaker and Cheryl Smith, we've been meeting every Wednesday in the coffee bean over at UNLV for several years now. And a lot of this work is because of their hard work, as well as the folks over at the Las Vegas Global Economic Alliance and the Governor's Office of Economic Development, who aren't here today because they are up in San Francisco at a bioskills or a med bio group trying to recruit companies down here. So what brought us here today? So we decided to go on a journey of positioning Las Vegas to become the most globally recognized destination for health and wellness travel. Back when we started this journey, it was known as medical tourism. We personally don't care for that term. A lot of people don't go, hey, I'm looking for something to do. Let me go for a weekend vacation and let me get some medical procedures done while I'm on vacation. It just doesn't work that way. And I think what you'll find are, although medical tourism as a whole has become a buzzword, it's a cottage industry and folks from all around the world are doing it. We always hear it coming out of the places like Costa Rica, Panama, Even Dubai is now building out medical tourism. We are taking a little bit of a different approach, and those of you that have been involved in the strategic planning process know that. But I want to go back and talk, for those of you that are new to the conversation, how this all got started. So in January 2012, we were just coming out of the recession. So Las Vegas, the heartbeat stopped. Those of you that were here realized that the economy tanked out and we were in a bad place. Rooms were not being filled. ADR, which is your average daily room rate, was down. And we looked at how can we align with the industry being hospitality, to partner up and make healthcare that much more important. And a lot of people in the business industry run away from that, what happens here stays here. They think that that's a bad thing. We in the healthcare industry say that's a good thing, because if you think about what that saying says, it screams anonymity. And if you think about healthcare, it's a very private matter. And so we started propping these two industries together, and again, to what is health and wellness travel. But on January 2012, we brought together stakeholders. And when I say stakeholders, it wasn't just the healthcare community going, how do we do this? And it wasn't just hospitality saying, hey, we want to get into this thing to fill our rooms. This was a large group. It was held down at Oscar's Steakhouse down at the Plaza. And Oscar showed up, as well as the other mayor, Mayor Carolyn Goodman, as well as city councilmen, legislators, physicians, hospital CEOs, hotel CEOs. We had about 130 of the community leaders in a room. And we opened up with just, let's have a conversation. We think that we could go on this journey to position Las Vegas to become a health and wellness travel destination. But it needs to be a community effort. It's not just an industry effort coming from healthcare or from hospitality. And we, on that particular panel, we had several presenters, including, at the time, Steve Hill from the Governor's Office of Economic Development. He was brand new in the seat, probably a couple months in. We had Glenn Christensen, who was the chairman of the Las Vegas Global Economic Alliance, which is our regional development authority. And they were looking at it from an economic development perspective. We had Valerie Wiener, who was the longest standing female legislator, senator at the time, and chaired the Health and Human Service Subcommittee up at the legislature. Then we had Jim Rogers from Channel 3. Many of you remember Jim. He was a great community supporter and a chancellor of our healthcare, our education system in town. And then we had somebody representing the Medical Tourism Association, which is a group based out of Florida that really, I'll give them kudos for bringing recognition to the idea of medical tourism. Our ideals don't necessarily align in that they're taking patients out of market. We're trying to bring patients into Las Vegas. So a little bit different. But what started that conversation was this little book up here that, thanks to the folks over at the LVCVA, Rossi Rowland-Cotter, Chris Myers, and now Cheryl Smith, put this book together to make this conversation real. Everybody then realized, wow, the industry is really getting behind this. And a couple months later, we assembled a panel discussion over at the Stan Fulton Building, and we invited in practitioners that were either doing medical tourism or their practices were well aligned to do medical tourism. And this included dental health as well. And we had fertility specialists, spine specialists, cancer specialists, orthopedics, all at the table talking about what was going on around the world and how Las Vegas could benefit from this. And again, it was all adding to the conversation of, this is real, we're going to head on this journey. This isn't a 3 months, let's put up a bunch of advertisements and make it happen. This is something that's going to take a long time. But we're going to write a strategic plan, and we're going to do it the right way, which led us to the strategic planning process. At the time, I reached across to Neil Smatrisk, who was the president of UNLV, and we said, look, if we're going to do this, we need academia involved. UNLV is the hotel school that's most globally recognized. We need them involved with us, and UNLV plays a key role in the community. So he assigned us a gentleman by the name of Jim Thompson, and I just want to talk a little bit about Jim, because a lot of people don't realize the brain power that resides in town. This is a gentleman that was the CEO of Rand Corporation for 20 odd years. Those of you that know Rand Corporation, it's the largest think tank group in the world. It's 2,600 PhD level researchers. And so we had somebody of that caliber that helped guide us through the process. And then Dean Stowe Shoemaker really took the reins from there and brought us to where we are today. But over the course of 2 years, it was actually about 18 months, we held a series of roundtable discussions, and we brought more and more folks to the table to ask, what does medical travel mean to you? How do we best leverage this opportunity? What do we have? What are we missing? Who's doing it? Who's doing it well? Why should we? How are we different than others? Because we don't want to be the low-cost provider. We don't want to win that race to zero. It's not a good place. I'm of the personal belief that healthcare has already been over-commoditized, and it's something that should not be commoditized. But how do we win it through quality? And so we had to address a lot of those things. We had 147 individuals and organizations involved in that process. So it wasn't just the three or four or five of us getting together at the coffee bean, thinking this strategic plan through. You, the community, were involved in this the whole way through. In June 2014, we released that strategic plan right here in the Oquendo Center. And that's when it became real. And what you'll find in that plan, and what you have in front of you has a lot of that original strategic plan in there, just so it could refresh everybody's memory of what was in there. And then we're going to talk about what brings us here today. So we're here 2 years later. And I'm going to plop down at the chair over there, and we just want to have a fireside chat with the folks that have been involved in this strategic planning process. And I encourage you, those that are in the audience, if you have questions along the way, come on down. Amanda's going to be, she'll have the microphone, I'll hand it to her, we'll ask the questions, and we really want this to be an engaging conversation, so please join us in that. So sitting here to my left, your right, is Cheryl Smith. And just to show you the commitment that the LVCVA made, Cheryl was hired on to be the medical tourism manager for the Las Vegas Convention and Visitors Authority. She is the first of its kind in the United States and the world. And her purpose was, how do I align tourism with medical? What a lot of people now know, Cheryl is also a 20 plus year healthcare marketing veteran. So she brought healthcare to tourism, and she learned the tourism piece. And Dr. Stowe Shoemaker, everybody knows from the hotel school, he's the dean of the hotel school. He has been involved in medical tourism efforts for some time, coming out of MD Anderson prior to moving to Las Vegas. So you've got experts that are here. So feel free to ask questions as we go, but I'm just going to open it up. So what have we been doing the last 2 years? A lot of people went, you guys went radio silent, and it really is not that case. So what have we been focusing on?
Well, the document that you have in front of you is, it's really, if you when you read through it, you'll notice a couple different themes in there. And one of the themes was really about capacity. You know, as we began to look at this whole area of health and wellness travel, what was our capacity issues? And another issue you'll see in here really relates to the area of connections. And what we, when we mean by connections is many times organizations work very independently, and it all, almost becomes kind of a zero-sum game of how do I take my share and take it from somebody else. We really wanted to look at what are the connections within the community that can help really build health and wellness travel. And I think you'll see that throughout the report. And the other thing that's really in the report, which Doug just alluded to, is really the fact of collaboration. That this was not just kind of a strategic plan that we sat at the coffee bean and decided to write, but it was really based on input from any of you in this room, lots of different conversations, and it was a working document, and still is a working, or as we say in academia, a living document, because it's always evolving. And I think what you'll see in this document is we started with coming up with six sort of overall strategic themes for where we should think health and wellness travel should go. we'll talk about each of these, you know, in a few minutes, but then really talking about, well, here's what we decided to do, what actually happened in these 2 years. And I think hopefully throughout this discussion tonight, you'll see that even though it's not a lot in the news, there's been a lot of things that we're really proud that all of us in this room and those who couldn't be here tonight have really helped take us to Las Vegas to the next level.
And Stowe, I'll build on that a little bit. From my personal experience working in healthcare here in Las Vegas since 1999 and prior to that in the Chicago market, I know from the healthcare provider side that there are many issues in this community and in the country in general that healthcare struggles with and has been struggling with for many years. And when we really started talking about the concept or the opportunity of health and wellness travel and medical tourism, what it really did is it brought our entire community, healthcare community, together, but it also brought the insights of some other players from the hospitality industry, as well as from the businesses and the business community that supports both the hospitality industry as well as the medical industry here. And when you start to have that dialogue and you bring that many different minds and different ideas together in around a particular conversation, it broke down a lot of barriers. And what we began to see after this plan was released was, when the original plan was released, is that these were beginning ideas, but it was a very nascent early step in this whole development process. So the report now is basically a dialogue, or the written version of a community dialogue that's been going on for some years, but truly, in the last 2 years, I do honestly believe that more has happened to move this whole conversation forward and to move the improvement of our healthcare delivery system forward in 2 years than probably has happened since my experience here in 1999.
Yeah, one of the big issues that we found, so as you go through the strategic planning process, you do a gaps analysis. So what are the assets that we have? What is it that we need? And what are those gaps that we need to fill? And clearly one of the gaps that we recognized early on from, again, leaning towards the theme of capacity, was we didn't have a workforce pipeline. So if we're really going to grow this sector, how do we make sure that we're growing the workforce necessary to deliver the services? And that's physician workforce. So we paused and we spent a great deal of our time on graduate medical education, and many of you were in this room when we started that conversation, which led to about $10 million coming out of the governor's budget to expand graduate medical education, which are physician residencies. And so to put some perspective as to what that does, going into this, we only had three hospitals that had formalized residency programs. And by the end of this year, we're gonna have 12 programs. That's quadrupling our capacity of training new physicians. And that laid the groundwork for UNLV and Roseman Med Schools to open. And what else it's going to do is, as they're recruiting faculty members for these new medical schools, these faculty members many times have their own practices and specialty areas. So then they start bringing in the specialists that start developing fellowship-based training programs, which many times are, that's the talent that we need to really grow the sector of medical tourism. So that was a big thing for us. How do we build the capacity so we could take a higher volume of patients and look at that? So I want to kind of open it up so everybody understands what the area. So Cheryl, can you talk about we called it the three-legged stool, or the three areas that we jumped in, and how we defined medical travel a little bit different. And then I really want to dive into the accomplishments, because that's why we're all here.
Sure. So one of the things that became very evident when I began working at LVCVA is that I noticed we had these big conferences and conventions that existed in our city, and they were all healthcare related. So the American Colleges of and the American Societies of, no matter what human body part you mention, pretty much all of those medical associations come through Las Vegas at some point in time for their annual meetings or their professional skill development, their continuing medical education programs, and so forth. So it really brought to light a whole nother perspective for what we were talking about medical tourism primarily originally in the concept of people individually traveling from one place to another, in particular here in Las Vegas, for a medical procedure or perhaps a dental procedure. But suddenly there were these medical meetings, and these were healthcare travelers who were traveling here, but for more of a business purpose or an educational purpose. So from that basis, we really started to take a look at, is medical tourism isolated to just the individual leisure traveler moving from one place to another, or does it have truly a broader definition? And we discovered that it did. So from LVCBA's vantage point, we look at this from three different perspectives, as Doug puts it, the three-legged stool. But we look at medical meetings, because that's very much a part of our community and our local industry. We also look at it from a wellness and spa tourism perspective. We have, many people don't realize that we do have 45 resort model spas that exist in our resort corridor, which is about a 5-mile or so stretch of land, that have more capacity to provide wellness and other types of health and spa services to a capacity that is unmatched anywhere in the world. We have more capacity in that 5-mile stretch of land than anywhere else on planet Earth for spa services. And then the third area, of course, is what we truly would consider or classify as medical tourism or dental tourism. And that specifically relates to more medical or surgical procedures. And so from that three-legged stool, we started to realize that there were a lot of medical providers in our community who were already doing, providing many of those services. It's just, I don't think our community historically ever looked at it as a tourism function. They looked at it as more physician referral development or community outreach, and many of the travelers that they were providing medical services to were either coming from the geographic region that we would consider more of a drive-in community, from maybe Pahrump or Mesquite or even Southern California and parts of Arizona, or they were treating our visitors who were already here, who may have been visiting for a completely different purpose, and during their stay had a medical mishap and somehow ended up in our healthcare delivery system. So those are really the three perspectives: medical meetings, spa and wellness travel, and then of course medical tourism.
And talk to us a little bit about, you know, what are the areas or the centers of excellence that we have here in Las Vegas? You know, obviously we're not a transplant capital, but we do have a lot of centers. What do those centers look like?
Sure. So initially, and again, I always put this in context of where we started and because we're talking about an accomplishments report, where we've ended up or where we're at right now. So initially, I think the dialogue pretty much focused around hospital services. And we started to talk to the hospitals. They were the largest providers of medical care here. And so a lot of the conversation stemmed from, well, what services are our hospitals providing? From that, our conversations really more or less shifted to individual physicians' practices. And I think while the hospitals are still very much engaged in this conversation and have a very important role, most of the services that are being provided are happening on more of an outpatient basis, and they're more physician-driven. So some of those specialties, and forgive me, please jump in, because I'm bound to leave one of them out or something, so I don't want to do that. But bariatric surgery, which is weight loss surgery, orthopedic surgery, neurosurgery, cardiology, help me out.
Fertility.
Brain health.
Oncology.
Eyes.
Ophthalmology, yes.
And we discovered
and
a couple.
Dental.
Yeah,
and
we
dental.
Discovered some of the opportunities. You know, probably one of the biggest ones out there is addiction services.
Mm-hmm.
You know, think about what, again, looking at the brand and the fact that we protect anonymity and the opioid, you know, the crisis that's going on around the country, and what Las Vegas can do there to help cure that problem. Because some of these folks that are addicted are high-level executives, and a lot of it is they don't want to admit. So to be able to say, yeah, I'm going to Las Vegas and there are a couple conferences back-to-back, and I'm going to be gone for 28 days, is a great way to look at that, and we think that there's a lot of opportunity there. We haven't explored dental services in a very meaningful way. I think there's a lot of opportunity that we're seeing with just the medical developments to kind of lean into that a little bit. You've got a couple clusters that are being built in town. You've got Union Village that's growing out, and then you've got the Las Vegas Medical District. And both of those are attracting specialty and subspecialty practices that are going to be built around medical travel.
I think another, excuse me, another area of really center of excellence that we often don't, we think about, but we don't think about it in terms of the medical side, is hospitality. And no one does hospitality as well as Las Vegas does. And a lot of times people say, well, hospitality, it's not rocket science. But you think about what are the characteristics of a rocket science. You know, you have a lot of people working for one project that's going to launch and either fails or it doesn't. It takes a lot of brain power. It's very expensive. And that's all of those characteristics really fit into hospitality. And as you all are aware, as medical payments start to change to, you know, the whole HCAT systems, suddenly everybody's looking around going, well, how do we make great patient experiences? And people are starting to look at, well, what do hotels do? What does the Ritz-Carlton do? What does the Four Seasons do? And that's very kind of a very simplistic approach to really how you create great services. And I think throughout the whole theme of, as we looked at health and wellness travel, was how do we take our knowledge of hospitality, whether that be on the side of revenue management, whether it be on the side of what we talk about in academia, the servicescape, how do you create an environment, how do you work with patient flow, how does that all come together to provide a great patient experience, whether it's for the medical tourism side for a specific procedure, or whether it's coming in because you're having a spa treatment, which has moved away from just getting a massage to much more medical kind of spas. So all of that themes as laid throughout the whole plan, because it gives us that area of expertise that can't happen in Costa Rica, it can't happen in India, it can't happen in other countries that don't have that knowledge and understanding of hospitality.
You know, I often reflect upon my first 6 months working at the LVCVA, and one of the things that my boss, Rossi, wanted me to go out and do was, because I came from healthcare, was to go out and really take a look at our hospitality industry. And so I literally, for the first 6 months, walked probably every hotel property in this city, as well as Mesquite, Prim, Laughlin. And it was funny because every facility, coming from healthcare, coming from a different, completely different industry, when I walked into hotels with this frame of mind, with the concept of medical tourism guiding me, I saw everything through a completely different lens. So suddenly, as I was getting toured through hotels, I would see these fantastic pools with beach entrances, you know, with you know, these fantastic, unbelievable experiences that are at our resort hotels. And in the back of my mind, all I saw was wheelchair accessibility. You know, here is a rolling in entrance into these pools, and all I'm thinking is, my goodness, this would be so accessible for somebody with a physical disability. You know, because again, it was a different frame of reference. But what Stowe's really talking about is it became very apparent even to me, and then in the course of the dialogue, as we began to integrate more people from the hospitality industry into the conversation with medical providers, was that there are a lot of best practices that happen every day and are very unapparent, just people aren't even aware that they happen in the hotels, that are transferable into the healthcare industry. And as you're, you know, as medical providers all looking to improve your HCAP scores, as more dependence is become, as it's becoming more dependent, to improve those patient satisfaction scores as that translates into reimbursement for medical providers, anything and everything that can be done to improve that patient experience becomes very valuable. And this is where that intellectual knowledge that resides in our hospitality industry here can become incredibly valuable. But moving on from that, I want to, you know, Doug, maybe we can talk about and bring everybody up to speed on the original six.
Do one of you want to touch on those six, and then if the audience is good with it, we'll kind of roll through each one. And again, I want us to focus more on the accomplishments. That's why we're all here today. So if one of you want to touch on the six, just so everybody understands what those are, and then we'll go one by one.
Yeah, so the six that we talked about in our initial proposal or plan, which are here, the first one was, we called health and wellness meetings and education. A second one was medical tourism, which really relates to the procedures. The third one had to do with spa and wellness tourism. We also had wellness travel agents and medical facilitators. them being the people who really help bring people to a destination for health and wellness travel. Looking at the whole area of packaging and bundling of services. And then the final one, another one was clinical trials. And our final strategy, that was our final strategy, clinical trials, yeah. Those six.
Let's touch on medical meetings. You know, it's, we talked a little bit about the Oquendo Center being here. Cheryl, you go out there and you sell the destination on medical meetings. I know I traveled to D.C. with you, and we hosted an event there to attract, bring medical meetings here. Talk to us about some of those conferences, and then I want to talk about what that means to you and what that means to medical tourism as a whole. So if you could touch on that.
So again, coming from the healthcare industry here and working on the hospital provider side, I was completely oblivious, frankly, to the number of medical meetings that come through our city. It was an eye-opener for me when I started to work at LVCVA and realized how many, literally tens of thousands of medical providers that come through our city that have no interaction, frankly, or very limited interaction with our local medical community. So I immediately saw this incredible opportunity, and I brought this basically to the table to start talking about was how do we begin to leverage or at least communicate or create the communication between these national meetings that come here and all of these professional societies that bring continuing education and the latest medical and healthcare technology and research and science. And how do we begin to utilize that or tap into that? How do we create the awareness among our local medical community that these programs are also available to them, that our doctors, our nurses, and our allied health providers, and our dentists, and our chiropractors, they don't necessarily need to leave Las Vegas. That education all travels right through here on a fairly frequent basis. Some of those meetings are annually. Some of them take place every other year or every 2 years, every 5 years. So it was a huge opportunity. But more so than that, we discovered that there were facilities like the Oquendo Center, and we do have some others in the community as well. And facilities like this one in particular that provide the hands-on bioskills training facilities is invaluable. Many of our hotels have the capability and the desire and the willingness and the staff and the facilities to accommodate surgical skills training, but many of them don't, or they're not interested. So it's places like Oquendo Center that provide this alternative location for doctors to be able to do that hands-on training. And if any of you have ever seen a cadaver lab, and if those of you who are physicians, you certainly know what's involved. But if any of you have seen a cadaver lab, it may not be something that a hotel wants to set up and then clean up for a wedding that evening or for some other type of banquet. So facilities like Oquendo certainly fill a special need. And the beauty of it is that we have several of these facilities right here in Las Vegas. So it becomes a huge asset.
So I want to talk a little bit about the partnership that's really formed between the LVCVA and Las Vegas Heels and how this benefits this group. So as these conferences are coming into town, we're able to hyper-target them in terms of what is that conference, what are the type of specialists that are coming in for that conference, and a couple different things. A, do we need that type of specialist to relocate or expand their practice to Las Vegas? And B, or can that person refer patients here? So each and every one, we approach a little bit different. I'll give you a quick story of one that this was about 2 or 3 years ago. It was minimally invasive surgery week, and we decided let's go out and let's recruit surgeons, and I had never done that before. So I stood out in front of a booth, and just as everybody walked by, I said, hey, would you ever consider relocating or expanding your practice to Las Vegas? And they would laugh, and they go, what, did you come down from the penthouse suite to have breakfast or lunch at the buffet? And, you know, it gave us a chance to engage in a conversation and let them know that, no, Las Vegas is a community of 2.2 million people. And we have 6 million business delegates that come through this community every single year. And they're tied to this community. They come here constantly, and we had 42 million visitors that came through. That's a lot of capacity. And lo and behold, one of the folks that stopped by our booth is now expanding it's a spine practice into Las Vegas. And he's investing about $10 million into the local market to expand their practice.
And Doug, I just want to piggyback on that a little bit too, because it was really, I think, those types of interactions and experiences that also brought up another issue in terms of, goes back to the bigger, broader strategy of capacity and service delivery. And that was, when we're talking about the shortage of physicians in our community, there's two ways you get them. You either grow your own from elementary and high school and up into secondary education, or you have to attract them to the community. And what Doug's talking about in terms of attracting, you know, positioning Las Vegas Heels in the center of some of these educational conferences and then working on that to promote the city as a place to do business also brought up some other problems, one of them being the licensure process. And is that it would take, what, it was over 6 months or something for physicians to be licensed?
It's taken about 6 to 9 months. And when we realized that that was a hurdle, we worked, again, this was a connection. We worked with the Governor's Office of Economic Development, and we were successful in passing an expedited licensure bill. So that reduced the time of getting a doctor credentialed from that lengthy time down to, in theory, it's supposed to take less than 45 days. This particular surgeon that we recently credentialed, it took us 72 hours. And that connection would not have happened if it didn't start from these conferences. So that's this capacity building and these connections that we're talking about. And I want to spend some time, Stowe, you've got a conference coming up in November, and this is a conference of its own, but this is what where we start blending in, again, the core industry in Las Vegas, which is hospitality and healthcare. Can you tell us a little bit about that conference?
Yes, and I think what's important is in this first strategy, it's meeting events and education. And so it's not just people coming in for specific meetings, but it's also how do we look at educational opportunities in Las Vegas? And Doug will talk shortly about the medical schools that have come about in the last 2 years since we started the strategic plan. But one of the things that we're doing in hospitality is we're having our second annual healthcare and hospitality conference, November 14th, and Kimberly Spencer's in wave your hand, Kimberly. She's working very diligently on the conference through what we call our Center for Professional and Owned Executive Education, the Plus Center. And it's really taking a look at, you know, what are the, when we had our first conference last year, we had over 100 and something attendees, really looking at what are some of the lessons that help, what are some of the lessons in hospitality that could be transferable to healthcare. And then we had people from the healthcare profession talking about some of the issues that they do deal with that could help hospitality. So we've always positioned this conference as not a, well, we're in hotels, we should tell you how to treat patients, but much more a collaboration of what are some of the issues that each of us face in dealing with either patients or dealing with customers, and how do we use our knowledge of both our practices to overall improve a better patient experience. And we talk a lot about in hospitality or for the healthcare work is we don't call them, we look at how do we create, make patients feel like loved family members. And that sort of becomes the whole theme of this year's conference is how do we make people feel like loved family members when they enter a healthcare facility or for a procedure, enter a hospital, or just entering the doctor's office.
So I want to spend a little time, an aha moment that we came to as we were going through this planning process was, you know, we were looking at other countries like Costa Rica, Panama, Mexico, and we talked to some of the early innovators of medical tourism, the folks that architected the Walmart plan, okay? So we had this gentleman come into Las Vegas, and they started out with an international medical tourism strategy, and it failed. And when we asked why did it fail, it was pretty simple. 80% of their workforce did not have a passport to travel outside of the country. So then we started going, well, what about domestic medical tourism? Because people like to go close to where they live. And then we started diving in as a group going, well, who is the ultimate consumer of healthcare? It's not really the end consumer, you and I. We go where our insurance company tells us to go. And there's a big trend going on with self-insured groups. Larger companies are starting to self-insure, and they're able to direct where that care goes. And that's where these third-party administration groups come about. And so one of the opportunities in here, bringing again medical meetings and opportunity There's an opportunity for us to market and attract more of the TPAs and the self-insured groups to come into Las Vegas so A, we could better understand their needs, and B, begin to introduce them to what Las Vegas has to offer. Cheryl, we worked with one in particular, IHC, and you coordinated a FAM tour. Mm-hmm. Can you share some of the experiences that came out of that?
Sure. We basically the Institute for Healthcare Consumerism, or IHC, brings their annual meeting to Las Vegas. They have an East Coast meeting in Atlanta and a West Coast meeting here in Las Vegas. So each one targets self-insured employers either on the East Coast or the West Coast. So their meeting here in Las Vegas attracts annually about, I think, somewhere between 400 and 500 self-insured employers. And what was interesting is that prior to our really integrating and working with them is I had actually gone to attended their conference in Atlanta just to hear the dialogue on the employer side and hear some of the issues that they were struggling with. And it was an incredible opportunity to basically hear the complete reverse of what I hear from medical providers and healthcare providers, struggling with many of the same issues, trying to figure out how to improve from their perspective the healthcare and the wellness of their employee workforces, how to do it at a lower cost and a higher quality, higher productivity level, how to return employees back to work, many of the same issues that I hear from many, many years on the healthcare side. So again, it presented that opportunity to spark a conversation with IHC. And so we hosted a familiarization tour, and this is something that LVCVA does with travel buyers and meeting planners and so forth, but primarily travel agents in the travel industry. But we hosted a familiarization tour. It was kind of the first of its kind, really, where we took self-insured employers and made some stops, planned a full day itinerary, and we went to some key medical providers, hospital, as well as outpatient centers and so forth, so that they could actually see the types of facilities that we're providing here. And the intention was really to start a new conversation, to start a dialogue between, you know, what do providers here offer that self-insured employers might be willing to direct contract for that could help attract people from their among their employees to Las Vegas for medical care? Were there some opportunities? And we took away from that actually the fact that there were several. And along the way, actually also learned that we had several physicians' practices including outpatient surgery facilities that they own and operate that were actually already in this space, that were already pursuing direct contracting relationships with self-insured employer market. So from that, we realized there were still a lot of unknowns. So if you're not getting the idea already, everything that we pursued brought up another what-if question. And from that what-if question led us down a completely different path. So it really wasn't just the three of us sitting here trying to figure this all out and navigate all of this. It was really the help of our medical community, but also the help of a lot of other professionals that we were able to identify through connections at these various conferences that come through town.
So I think what you'll see is there's a great way for us to leverage the capacity of medical meetings that are coming into town to A, help skill up our existing workforce, B, recruit folks to come here, and C, reach buyers of healthcare. So I want to move to medical tourism, and I'm going to go grab a water, but if you guys want to touch on medical tourism and get that started, that'd be great.
Obviously, in the area of medical, specifically medical tourism, I mean, I don't speak for the medical community here, but I can honestly say that as we really started to dive into what does medical tourism look like in this community, what are our needs, what are our growth opportunities, what's the potential, I have to honestly say it was, you know, I have great appreciation for the physicians in our community who stepped forward and shared some of their best practices and some of their models. So, you know, in very specific specialties, especially in the area of orthopedics and bariatric surgery, we have some very well-developed practices that were already providing medical tourism services. We found in the area of oncology that we had a lot of people traveling into our community for clinical trials, which is, again, a somewhat different form of medical tourism. And the Lou Ruvo Center for Cleveland Clinic, Lou Ruvo Center for Brain Health, was also instrumental in sharing not just what they're doing here in Las Vegas, but some of the best practices that they're doing at the Cleveland Clinic in particular. And how could we start to explore the what-if possibilities of creating some of those opportunities in Las Vegas. But it also opened up a whole bunch of other doors, and one of them in particular that I want to touch on, because I see Donna sitting in the audience, is that it broadened our scope of looking at what medical tourism is into other areas of what businesses help support the movement of patients from one place to another for medical care. Donna's company, Flying ICU, is one that we discovered is very much tied to both the tourism side of what we do, but also the medical side of what our community does. And her company is actually in the business of providing medical transport around the world, to and from, through Las Vegas, around Las Vegas, over Las Vegas, in and out of McCarran, however, you know, whichever path is required. So again, offered this broader global scale, brought a global perspective to what we were starting to explore and do.
It's one of the areas I want to talk about as well. As we went on this journey, we toured around the United States and even outside of the United States to look at these medical tourism type meetings. And one that really educated us was we traveled to Montreal, Canada. And so looking at Canada, they've got access issues to healthcare. So many of you know that their system doesn't allow for patients to get quick access to certain things like hip and knee replacements, bariatric type procedures. So when we went to Montreal, we learned what Florida was doing to attract some of these patients from Canada down there through their snowbird program. And how they use supplemental insurance to track some of these patients there. But really what it came down to, when somebody has a bad hip or knee in Canada, there's an 18-month waiting period. So what do? They start giving them painkillers. So now they have a patient that's addicted to painkillers, their stomach's rotted out, and they still haven't done the knee or the hip. Well, Las Vegas has, I believe it's 11 direct flights a day coming in from Canada. It's a large destination point, so there's opportunity there. And again, we wouldn't have learned that if we didn't travel to go visit some of these other medical meetings that are going, or medical tourism meetings that are going on out there.
I think, Doug, to piggyback on that, you know, when we start to take a look again at where do these industries intersect, you know, initially we start to look at this from a tourism perspective, but really this is more about the medical care that's being provided. However, when you look at how people move from one city to another, you have to take into account their transportation. And airline routes are a huge connectivity point. That's how people get to another place. When you look at the types of procedures that are occurring around the world and how people are traveling for those, the original theory globally, and I've researched this from country to country around the world, the original theory was that people from the United States and Canada were the primary targets for the rest of the globe. They still are. But the theory is that people from the U.S. and Canada would travel to parts of Asia or Europe or Latin America or other parts of the world, these very remote destinations, for surgical procedures. And the reality is that some of the medical procedures, if you have complications, it may not be appropriate for someone to be on a plane for 17 hours after having heart surgery or a heart transplant or some of these very critical procedures. So what has transpired over the last, I'd say, easily 5 years globally around the world is that these clusters have developed around continents, and the transfer of patients between countries, either within Europe or within parts of Asia, within the Middle East, within Latin America, within North America, as examples. So when you talk about Canada, and part of the reason why we went to that particular show was really to explore, do people really, are they willing to travel from Canada to Las Vegas or frankly anywhere in the U.S. for medical care? Was there an opportunity there? I think there clearly is, and we've started to see that. But And part of that gateway opens because it's easily accessible to get from every major city in Canada to Las Vegas.
But to stay on track with the connections and capacity, one of the things that we looked at is, you know, take a look around town and look at the growth that is going on within healthcare now. From Union Village with Henderson Hospital to St. Rose building a new tower, Spring Valley just is opening up their brand new tower. You've got Mountain View that's building a tower. You've got the medical district. That's all capacity building. And that's preparing for this growth area, not only for our own population, but the medical travelers that are coming in. And I think that's a big piece of what we're doing right now is how do we build out to handle this? One of the aha moments that we had going through this, because a lot of medical travel doesn't even happen in a hospital. When we started trying to figure out how to count medical travelers, we discovered that. A lot of this is done in an outpatient practice or an ambulatory surgery center. Did anybody realize we've got 79 accredited surgery centers in Las Vegas? That's probably more density of surgery centers than anywhere else in the world. That's capacity, and they are not being utilized at the highest level. So we're looking at that going, how do we align that opportunity? And we'll touch on a conference that we're coordinating that brings together the investment community and the developer community. Again, another connection. But to take the assets that we already have in Las Vegas and just simply leverage those. Let's go ahead and move on and let's talk about spa and wellness tourism. Cheryl, this is your bailiwick.
Sure.
You know, tell us a little bit about what's going on and some of the accomplishments over the last couple of years and the new spas that have been built.
Sure. So as I mentioned earlier, we have 45 resort model spas in essentially a 5-mile stretch of land. One of the things that many people, unless you have actually been in one of them and actually spent some time there, is they have incredibly large capacity. The Canyon Ranch Spa Club, for example, at Venetian Palazzo, is actually the largest resort model spa in the United States. So for anyone who's visited a spa, many of the ladies have, it is so big you can literally be lost in that spa. So you almost have to have a guide to get you from one end to the other. But the types of services that are being offered in the spa, our resort spas do not provide any invasive services. So they are not doing any sort of Botox services, nothing that's injectable, nothing that's is invasive in any way. However, they do provide a lot of relaxation services, different types of massage, different types of nutrition counseling, fitness counseling. They provide a lot of fitness classes. And some of the unique opportunities around that that we discovered are, for example, in talking with our physicians who specialize in infertility treatment here. We discovered in talking to them that they actually, when their patients come in for fertility treatment, they're encouraged not to go bungee jumping or horseback riding or do anything too physically active. Instead, the doctors are actually recommending to their patient and sometimes the couple to go to a spa. This is part of the doctor's prescription. Go and relax. Enjoy your stay. You know, have a nice dinner and go to the spa and have a nice massage. So we started to build upon where there are some other opportunities that may exist, some other synergies between our healthcare community and the spa and wellness community. And we discovered, and we're still beginning to uncover more of those. I pointed out to Canyon Ranch in particular because that spa is actually based and was built upon a medical model. Many of our other spas are not based on the same model, but they do provide a lot of other services that traditionally healthcare might have considered to be community education years ago. And many hospitals in our community, for example, and many healthcare providers no longer provide those educational classes and services. And so those are now offered on more of a retail basis through spas, not just here in Las Vegas, by the way, but that's across the United States and actually across the world. But again, because we have such a concentration of spa, it opens up the opportunity. The other thing I want to touch on is the concept of wellness. And again, healthcare has a very different definition of wellness than, frankly, I think most consumers have. So when we talk about wellness, we're not just talking about having your labs done and cholesterol checks and checking what your glucose levels are and so forth, but we're really looking, talking about the concept of one's overall well-being, your state of mind, the mind-body-spirit connection, or mind-body-soul connection. And when you start to look at wellness from a well-being perspective, it opens up a lot of other opportunities when you consider what Las Vegas offers. So not only do we offer spa and relaxation services, but we are surrounded by national parkland. Many of our visitors who come to Las Vegas come here for the purposes of hiking the Grand Canyon, going to Red Rock, and taking advantage of physical activities available at Valley of Fire or Lake Mead National Recreation Area. They're coming to participate in other things. Yes, they might also visit the resort corridor, they might be staying there, but they're coming here for some other type of outdoor experience, which, again, in the context of wellness, one often looks at me and says, you know, Las Vegas, wellness travel, are you kidding? What's going on here? But the reality is we have all these attributes and other attractions here that are famous, and we've never really looked at them from that perspective. So it's brought up a lot of key opportunities.
And one of the things that's actually happened, MGM has put in what they call their wellness suites. And we're at the university doing research on the wellness suites right now. And basically what these rooms are, and they sell these rooms at a premium price, but the rooms have citrus-infused shower heads. They have ambient lighting that keeps your melatonin in the body. They have white noise. They're, the beepers that you turn on the TV off, the TV on and off, are all, you know, sealed in a way that they're germ free, and so you think about coming to Las Vegas, and people are actually spending more money to stay in these rooms, to the point where MGM started with like maybe 150 rooms, and now they're adding another couple hundred, and these are, you know, quite expensive rooms to put in and maintain, but people are coming to Las Vegas because of these rooms, and now they've started, they have what they call their wellness meetings, and their meeting rooms are designed with the same kind of approach so that when the meeting's over, you don't walk out exhausted, but you stay energized. And that's this whole part of Las Vegas moving away from kind of this perception of sitting in a casino gambling, but really being in kind of an open wellness environment. And you look at what MGM is doing, which really all the major properties are doing, by creating all this open space, a lot of walking, a lot of parks that creates this, so you can be on the resort quarter, but you can be walking and being outside. All of that is really repositioning us as a health and wellness destination. And that's really why we moved away from just calling it medical tourism, but health and wellness travel. You can come, you can stay in a wellness suite, you can walk outside on the strip, you can have spa services, and it's all about rejuvenation in a healthy way.
And just one other comment about the Stay Well meeting concept at MGM. It's actually been something that the entire meetings industry in the United States has really taken note of, to the extent that there are many meeting industry trade organizations that have started to begin to integrate, no matter what their meeting is, no matter whether it's a healthcare meeting or a financial meeting or a pharmaceutical meeting, or it could be an automotive related, any industry, they are all starting to consider ways of integrating the concept of health and wellness into their meeting experience. And this is another potential and opportunity, as well as synergy between the healthcare community and our local meetings industry and trade show business, because they're relying upon the resources in our community to be brought into their meeting experience. Sometimes the hotels can provide that through their spas, but sometimes they need to reach out. They're looking for a local medical provider who can come and do a special type of fitness educational program, or it might be a nutrition related program, could be a fitness class, any number of things, or even to help them with creating healthy menus to be offered during their program. So again, you know, I keep coming back to this whole idea that every time we, you know, turn a new leaf, we discover that there's a whole new tree underneath it, and it just keeps branching from one thing to the next.
So all these travelers are getting here through travel agents. At the same time, outside of the United States, there's something that's commonly known as the medical facilitator. It's not so common here. So the medical facilitators basically are commissioned to take patients and send them to Costa Rica, send them to Panama, to Mexico. And obviously, in the U.S., we're governed by this little thing called the Stark Laws, so we're not able to do that. But wellness travels, there's wellness travel agents that are coming about, and what we discovered as we were unearthing this is, although we don't have medical facilitators, that's where we saw the opportunity with these third-party administrators and those that manage the larger self-insured groups, because they're the ones that can refer or direct care to a destination. But tell us, Cheryl, the LVCVA really did a great job and sponsored some meetings to help educate people on wellness travel. Can you touch on that a little bit?
One of the biggest things that we did, and this actually started about 3 years ago, but really solidified over the last two, was that we partnered with the Travel Institute. The Travel Institute is an organization that certifies and accredits travel agents and provides their continuing education credits. So if any of you have, for example, seen a travel agency, a retail location, and you'll see cruise ship posters, and you might see Africa safari posters. These are travel agents who specialize in that particular type of travel, to that either that particular type of mode of transportation like cruise ships or maybe that particular destination. So the Travel Institute and I got together and we started to have this conversation more around wellness travel. And it brought up a whole nother dialogue, frankly, in terms of, well, who is the target audience? What does a wellness traveler look like? What demographic is that? Are they male? Are they female? Are they old? Are they young? Are they boomers? Are they millennials? If anybody has an answer to that, let me know. But the reality is, we believe it's everybody. Anybody who's concerned about their overall health and well-being can frankly be a wellness traveler. And so travel agents immediately began to see that this was an opportunity for them to sell their travel products and their destinations in a completely new way. So the LVCVA, we took a leadership role in that, and we sponsored an online educational course for travel agents to understand the difference between what medical travel is and what wellness travel is and where the opportunities existed for them. And on the medical side, travel agents realized very quickly that there was a type of liability that maybe they didn't want to have have on their shoulders. The idea of connecting their clients through travel to a medical provider could be perceived as a little too risky because they can't control the outcome, especially if they were taking that client and booking travel out of the country. If something goes wrong with that medical procedure, the travel agent is in the liability loop. So travel agents started, frankly, across the country, backing away a little bit from the concept of medical travel, leaving that to medical facilitators who are a little more, they're trained in how to make those appropriate connections. And travel agents have really shifted more toward booking wellness travel and trying to identify those attributes of a particular destination that would fit their clients' wellness needs.
So what you're hearing is, again, on the line of capacity building and building that infrastructure. So I want to move to bundled payments and packaging, bundling of services. So this, in the medical tourism world, is important. A lot of your medical travelers are cost conscious. They're looking for, they want a flat rate. And they don't want to go to a facility to get 10 bills over the next 8 months. They're looking, what's it going to cost? So we spent a lot of time diving into this. We've got a couple practitioners in town that have really done well in this model. And I don't know if Dr. Crivetti's here tonight. I don't see him. I see Dr. Umbach up there. I know he's doing some bundling. But what that is it's the ability to give a single price to a buyer so they know what they're purchasing. And there's to help better understand that, and it was a different conversation that we held in this room on reimbursements, but we had some experts in this space. We brought in a gentleman that was a staff member to the Senate Finance Committee during the birthing of the Affordable Care Act. And inside of the Affordable Care Act, there was a little piece of legislation called MACRA that nobody was certain if they were ever going to fund it. And by golly, they funded it last April. And so what MACRA is, it's where Medicare is heading. And it's the global payment model, a bundled payment, saying, if this procedure gets done, here's what you're going to get paid. And if you deliver a good outcome, guess what? you're going to earn more because we're going to give you some bonus points. If you deliver an outcome that's less than the national standard, we're going to claw back a little bit. And so we brought those experts out, and Las Vegas is fortunate to be one of, I believe it's 50 pilot cities in the United States on what we consider the leading edge of macro, and that's called CCJR, which is its complete joint replacement. So it's very much like what Dr. Crivetti's doing, except they're compensating a hospital. So they're going to hospital saying, hey, if you're gonna do a knee or a hip on one of our patients, we're gonna pay you $27,000, and I don't know if that's the number, $27,000, and you figure it out. You pay the doctor, you pay the anesthesiologist, you pay for the implant, the rehab. Well, guess what? That bundled package is very similar to how medical travel works. So we're spending a great deal of our time understanding that bundled model. And then at the same time, we brought out a couple experts that are, one was one of the key architects behind the Walmart program, and the other one publishes a international and a domestic medical travel magazine. And we brought those folks here to teach us a little bit. So Cheryl, talk to us a little bit about, you know, the importance of that and that bundled price.
Well, it really comes down to how medical travel is marketed and how it's bought is the two simplistic ways of looking at it. So if you take a look at all of these foreign countries, and they are all over the world that are pursuing this, they see the United States and the problems that we have in the US with our healthcare delivery system as prime opportunity to target Americans for low-cost procedures. And some of them have been very successful, and some of them are still struggling with that. On the flip side, you have a lot of Americans who don't have the ability to travel out of the country or just don't have a willingness to do it. And you have employers who are looking for direct contracting relationships that can help them improve the quality of their employee workforce, and they want to be able to direct contract. But because employers carry so much of the financial burden of providing healthcare coverage, that they're kind of saddled with, kind of struggling between, you know, do we send our employee population out of the country for lower cost procedures, or do we find a domestic alternative? So some major employers have actually pursued this. Walmart, Lowe's Corporation, PepsiCo, McKesson, I mean, there's a significant list. And what Doug is talking about, the key architects of some of these plans, we brought these people here to help educate our community and help inform us as to, you know, how did they put those plans together and what kind of outcomes did those employers have and see, and how does that translate to what we want to do and where Las Vegas fits into that picture. And I think Lowe's Corporation was probably the most interesting example because they had been in this space for about 5 years, and they had trended data over 5 years, and they saw that as they were sending people out of the country, they were coming back, but they couldn't get them, their employees returned to work fast enough because they were struggling with either procedures going wrong and complications when the employee came back, and they had all sorts of other issues that were problematic on the employer side. So that's really kind of what led us down the path of being a domestic alternative, or being the domestic alternative. So there are still many, many countries that are developing their programs very, very aggressively and are actively marketing what they do in the United States. They literally drop into a particular state, particular city. They host big events for physicians. They host consumer-facing events to try to attract people to their city. But there still seems to be a market hesitation overall on the part of many Americans to go out of country because we have this intrinsic desire and expectation of a high quality product. So many of us, while yes, you might be purchasing healthcare on the lowest cost, it calls into question, is that really the highest quality care? If I'm paying, if it costs X amount in the United States and they're offering it to me for, a fraction of that cost, is it really a good product? Is it really what I want to purchase? So this is the kind of struggles. While we have our own struggles developing our program, please know that all of our competitors out there around the world are facing somewhat different but also complicated problems.
One thing that's very interesting about bundled payments, and when you look at the hospitality industry, we know how to price our products. Sometimes it's frustrating when we're, you know, when we look at how we do demand-based pricing. But one of the things that we begin to look at UNLV in healthcare, and I've been doing some work with MD Anderson, is really taking a look at how do we manage our magnets, right? We have high demand, so that the initial assumption is, well, let's buy more magnets. But as we've worked with MD Anderson, and we're still in discussion phase, this is really looking at, tell me when you want to have your CT done, and we'll tell you what you have to pay. Tell me what you want to pay, and we can tell you when your CT scan can be done. And much more flexibility in terms of taking our knowledge of how we've managed revenue in our hotels, taking that and applying that to the healthcare field. Because everybody has a certain willingness to pay. And you'll begin to see over time that there'll be a lot of understanding of how do we take that flat rate that the government pays us, and how do we squeak a little more profit out of it. Because if everybody pays the same, everybody wants to go when it's most convenient. And over time, you're going to begin to see that payments are going to start to change in terms of how much people are willing to pay in terms of when they can have those procedures. And that knowledge that we have from hospitality is going to be very helpful here within the community.
Obviously, those are oftentimes tied to academic medicine. So as Roseman University and UNLV come online, as well as Touro continues to grow, we're going to see more and more clinical trials coming into Las Vegas. One of the recent things that occurred was the Cleveland Clinic partnered up with UNLV and received an NIH grant, I believe to the tune of about $11 million to create the COBRI, which is the center. Gosh, I just lost my place on here, but it's It's the Center for Biomedical Research Excellence, and that's one of the largest NIH grants that Las Vegas has ever seen. The UNLV also formed what's called NIPM, the Nevada Institute of Personalized Medicine, which is basically a DNA mapping system, which is going to allow people to, for lack of a better term, spit into a cup like 23andMe, but at a higher level. And they're tying that to the supercomputer that's over at Switch to be able to identify disease states that may be prevalent in your body before you even know it, so you could start working to avoid the progression of those. But we see clinical trials is a big area, and do you all have anything to contribute on those?
Well, I think the thing that we often forget about, and this is what's really exciting about what's happening at UNLV, is that with our partnership with Switch, we probably have access to one of the world's top fastest supercomputers. And when you think about clinical trials, what's happening now in clinical trials, it's being all data-driven. How do we reduce the cost of clinical trials? And we have masses and masses amounts of data that we've collected over the years as companies put products into market that fail or don't fail. And using really high-powered statistical analysis that can only be done really on supercomputers, we're able to start to really develop a whole infrastructure. So I think the future is with UNLV, with the Brain Center, with the partnership with Switch, is you'll see more and more companies starting to relocate to Las Vegas because they have access to the supercomputer. We see so many visitors coming to town that we can do all these clinical trials right here in Las Vegas. And it's very easy to get in, to get a trial, and fly out of.
It was interesting. We had a new member join Heels the other day, and they are doing a tremendous amount of clinical trials. And when we asked, well, why Las Vegas? They said, well, if you think about it, clinical trials, you need to have a diverse population that you're delivering this to. And if you look at Las Vegas, there's not a more diverse population in the country, because you're made up of everybody else's people. And for us to be able to reach that, we could do it right in one city. And it makes it easier for that access point. So with that being said, I want to open it up to questions. We promised to do that. I'm going to hand the microphone to Amanda. So if anybody has any questions, I'm going to work my way back to the podium so I can get the final slides up, and then we'll get everybody off to food and drinks.
So I was hoping that maybe you guys could possibly speak to how you're working in the hospitality realm to get the hotels ready for all these visitors that are coming. have you done any work in that space? I know Cheryl and I have talked about it from time to time.
I think Stowe can probably address this from a slightly different perspective than I can. But so one of the things that we've done is very clearly realize that some hotels in our town are probably not the best place for medical travelers to stay. But at the same time, we have some that are ideally suited for that. And many of them are located very near and dear to medical providers. And so one of the fantastic synergies and benefits that has resulted from this is that I've been able to introduce those doctors, those hospitals, those outpatient facilities, those care centers directly to the hotels that are immediately within their neighborhoods or that are the best suited places for their patients to stay. And as a result, we actually have a couple of different hotels that have actually created medical tourism programs. One of them, for example, is Hilton Grand Vacations. These are all condo properties. So they are 1 and 2 bedrooms. They have in-room kitchens and kitchenettes. You can stay for an extended period of time. It's not like you're staying in a small hotel room. It's like it's staying in a condo or an apartment. Many of them do offer accessible facilities that have wheelchair accessibility, so if somebody has a walker or a brace or a cast or something and needs to have more space getting in and out of a shower, they don't have to try to crawl into or get into a big tub. That could be difficult. So it's programs like that that really have opened up the eyes, I think, to which hotels are interested in this space, which ones are interested in hosting medical travelers in their hotels, which prefer to really target the wellness traveler. So it's very becoming more clear, I think, every day.
And I think I see Dr. George in the back as a prime example of and if you can take him the mic, he can maybe just spend a minute on what he's doing and taking really concierge medicine to the hotels and making hotels more accessible for people who want to come in. And I'll let him give a minute.
All the way at the top.
All the way at the top. Because what he's doing is, I think it's a prime example of what we talk about with making Las Vegas much more health and wellness oriented.
Thank you. Is this on?
Yeah.
So what we're doing is a couple of different things. I'm an internist and a pediatrician here in town, born and raised here, homegrown, have my private practice for 11 years, and we're doing two things. In about 2 weeks, I'm opening up Hygieia Health and Wellness. It's the first combined internal medicine pediatrics office here in Las Vegas, concierge services. And along with that, with Tyra Bell Holland, we're doing ResortCiergeMD. And so what we've done to kind of build on this medical health and wellness tourism aspect that UNLV and LVCA and Las Vegas Heels is on board with is we work with the hotels. So if we have guests that are in town, international or national, they don't know where to go. They're sick. Where do you go? You open the phone book, you go on your phone, where's the nearest emergency room, urgent care? They're scared. They have no idea. They're not from here. Some of them don't speak the language. So they depend heavily on the hospitality component in the hotel, which is the concierges. So we've developed networks with them. And if there's a client that's ill and not feeling well, they'll reach out to our facility. And we actually send a physician, myself, and we'll actually go see them in their hotel room. It's the comfort of their own hotel. They're there. They feel comfortable. They know where they're at. We get phone calls from the patients. We get phone calls from the concierge. We get funneled through Tyra. She'll call me. We'll triage them. And then I contact the patient on the phone before I even see them, kind of get an idea of what's going on. And it's the hospitality part. You reach out to them before you actually arrive at the hotel room so they kind of have an idea of who's coming, who is this person, what do they say, what do they think. Go to the hotel room, see the client. Call in prescriptions. We have courier services that provide prescription pickup for them. So it's kind of all rotating around hospitality and healthcare, meaning they come here for an experience. You want them to stay on the strip. You want them to spend money, go to the shows, go to the restaurants. So the purpose of having us here is to kind of get them back on their feet in a quick turnaround way, give them a great experience. So when they do leave and come back, they can say, hey, I was in Vegas. Unfortunately, I was sick during my stay there. I had a great experience. I would go back in a heartbeat knowing that if anything were to happen healthcare-wise, we have a backup system, and that's kind of, I think, what we're trying to do with Las Vegas Heels and everybody involved here in the room today to kind of progress that and make that product known, not just locally, but nationally, internationally, obviously, too. So that's kind of what we're doing on our behalf to kind of support what you guys up there are doing as a whole for the entire community to benefit all of us, obviously. So.
And I wanted Dr. George to talk about that, because what happens then, from a hotelier's perspective, it takes away that fear of, oh, we have somebody sick. Why would we want to do something? So now all of a sudden the market segment opens up. They see that they have people who are coming in. They see they can be taken care of. They find that it's not so scary. And so then you'll begin to see more and more hotels opening up and moving in this direction.
Okay, do we have any other questions, or let's go ahead and bring this to a close if we don't. So I've got a couple other things coming up. You heard us make mention of the healthcare trends, which is a real estate summit. And this is in line with capacity building. So on the 18th of October, we've partnered up with Colliers International to bring together the investment community, as well as the development community, the architects, the developers, the construction companies, to take a look at where our gaps exist within the community and put money with the folks that are looking to build. So that is going live on the 18th. That evening as well, just to kind of put a little context to how we're getting a national message out, many know that the final presidential debate will be held right here in Las Vegas. It's going to be housed over at the Thomas and Mack facility, and we're expecting in the tune of about 7,000 journalists circling around Las Vegas. We have assembled a task force made up of our legislative council and our communications council to identify local Las Vegas-based stories that we can work with the national media outlets that have national appeal, but they're going to be looking for local level stories. So we're going to be holding a media night that evening to hopefully get some of that messaging out there to the public. Finally, we've got our annual gala coming up. This is our fifth annual gala. It's going to be on the 27th of October over at the Four Seasons. Last year we had about 440 in attendance. This year we're expecting about 500. It's going to be a great event where we all come together, and you'll never see all of the C-suites of all the facilities out in one night. It's an amazing event. I saw Dr. Adeshek walk in here earlier. He was one of our recipients last year, so kudos there. So the nomination process on this just opened up yesterday. So if you have folks that you'd like to nominate for that, it's very selective. We only have 6 awardees each year. You'll get an email tomorrow with the ability to nominate your favorite physicians. And then finally, you heard Stowe talk about the Hospitality and Healthcare Conference. That is going to be on November 14th over at the Stan Fulton Building. So as you can see, we've got a full agenda throughout the remainder of the year. At this point, we're going to adjourn this. We've got food and beverages outside. Please enjoy yourselves and get to the connectivity point of this, which is part of the plan. Get to know one another and make connections happen. So thank you all for being here tonight, and we'll see you out in the lobby.